One of the hardest things for corporations is to balance the need to keep growing and evolving, but at the same time, stay true to the values that got you to where you are. It's always the balance between, on the one hand, being aggressive about opportunities in the future, on the other hand, not removing yourself from the roots that made you who you are today.
We had a research analyst named Ben Rosen. He called us up to his office where he had an Apple II. And he said, look at this machine and look at what it can do. I don't know anything about the company, but you guys better go out and call on them.
It was a company that was less than 4 years old and named after a fruit. Not exactly like Morgan Stanley's stable of blue chip clients.
Steve Jobs came in his trademark black turtleneck and put his bare feet up on the table and said, what does Morgan Stanley do? And he said, Jack, do you remember when they invented the wheel? The personal computer will be, to this century, what the wheel has been to civilization. And at the end of that meeting, we basically had a handshake on doing the initial public offering for Apple Computer.
Apple's just one of many examples of the firm working with entrepreneurs who were really building interesting and unique companies that were pioneers in their industry.
As Steve Jobs predicted, the personal computer became something that everyone had to have. But connecting all the computers in the world was an even bigger opportunity, and that wasn't as easy to spot.
Our research was pretty good. We know this big technology trend is happening, so we knew we were onto something.
Mary was talking about this thing called the internet, and nobody cared. I mean, we didn't have computers on our desks. It was kind of an amorphous phrase.
I will never forget sitting in the room with the Equity Capital Commitment Committee to discuss whether we should proceed with the Netscape IPO or not. People were so surprised that we were bringing a business like this, and I don't think they knew what questions to ask because it was so unusual.
The Netscape IPO launched the dot-com boom that fueled the late 1990s bull market.
That was the first of this generation of technology companies that went public where demand was wildly outstripping supply of stock. And people knew this was going to change the world. And off we went.
Internet stocks, they've been amazing performers,
yes.
Sue.
Little-known names have become superstars overnight.
People think that they're getting in on the ground floor of an industry that will transform the way America does business.
It was a really fun time, and we wanted to be super selective. People were coming up with ideas left, right, and center, and a lot of people were trying to figure out how to make money from it.
Including individual retail investors who began to play the stock market like never before.
Everyone was reading in the paper every day about the companies that were going public. And we were producing all these tech IPOs, and then we had to hand off the retail piece to sell.
By now, Dick Fisher and his protege John Mack were running the firm, and they saw an opportunity for a game-changing move to jump ahead of the competition.
This morning's business news, Morgan Stanley and Dean Witter Discover have announced a $10 billion deal that would create the world's largest securities firm.
In 1997, Dean Witter had grown into the third largest retail brokerage firm in the country, with over 8,500 financial advisors in all 50 states. They had even opened branches in hundreds of Sears stores.
We thought there was a real opportunity to put these two firms together. We did not have retail. We had a small high net worth business, which it was a great business, but only made a dent in our revenue flow. And here was a chance to have a huge business.
If Morgan Stanley was going to continue to be on the course that it was, it needed to get bigger. And one of the ideas was retail customers will like being associated with the brand of Morgan Stanley. And quite frankly, Morgan Stanley, the company, would benefit by more stable earnings, which a wealth management business brought you.
The industrial logic of it made a ton of sense. The marriage of product creation and product distribution seemed like a great idea.
Our competitors' reaction was just stark fear. They hated it. Virtually everybody accepted that this was a game-changing merger, that we had a competitive advantage now in every business.
Because Dean Witter had paid a premium in the merger, part of the deal was that Dean Witter's Phil Purcell became CEO.
They were bigger, their CEO became the CEO. So even though it was perceived as kind of a merger of equals, at the end of the day, Dean Witter basically took over Morgan Stanley.
It was a big step for us to take. It was not easy.
We shared the same vision. Our focus was to be the preeminent financial service firm in the world. But you're always worried about culture. And we were worried about it. I think they were worried about it. Because you don't really know until you try to put them together.
But the bull market, fueled by the tech boom, meant for the first few years, Morgan Stanley Dean Witter was thriving.
People liked the business mix. There was lots of underwriting. Our fixed income business was doing exceptionally well. The wealth management business was growing. Our asset management was great.
We were the dominant IPO underwriter. Our stock price was selling at 7x book. People start to think that's reality, which it wasn't.
And guess what? The tech bubble happened and the bottom fell out.
Today's drama follows yesterday's heavy sell-off.
The internet stocks the most volatile.
Amazon.com down sharply.
Yahoo
today.
Lost more than a third of its value.
AOL was down. Spyglass plummeted.
Stock is down 76%.
And the internet bubble, well, it's burst.
And all of a sudden, all of us who are used to our stock going up 15% a year like clockwork, all of a sudden it was down. And that was sort of a surprise.
With the market tanking from the 2000 tech crash, individual investors withdrew from the stock market. Quarterly earnings began to fall, and the firm's stock price was dropping steadily.
Suddenly, you now had to make hard decisions, and there were not agreements among senior leadership as to what things we would grow, what things we should shrink, where we should put our money or not.
There was an element of trying to de-emphasize some of the core institutional businesses that we were in, focus more on the wealth side and the retail side. So there was disagreement on the direction that the organization was going.
Was there grumbling? Of course there was. Compensation goes down precipitously. Everybody's unhappy.
Some of these political battles are starting to, starting to simmer. So the idea, if you think about politics and declining stock price, it's not a good recipe.
On January 25th, 2001, John Mack announced he would step down as president of Morgan Stanley.
It was a difficult environment during those years.
Are we still the same place? Are we a different place than we used to be? We're a little bit lost, frankly.
As soon as the first plane hit, we knew it was a terrorist attack. And then the second plane hit our building.
On September 11th, 2001, Morgan Stanley Dean Witter was the largest tenant in World Trade Center Tower 2, with 2,700 employees spread out across 22 floors. That morning, Phil Purcell and the management committee were meeting at the firm's Times Square office.
We had done enormous contingency planning, and I went back to my office, and we all started calling, making sure everybody did what they're trained to do, which to get out. We were counting down how many people were missing. First night was 750, second night was 250, and eventually it was down to 13.
It was a moment where the firm really came together. And Phil did a really good job of keeping people informed, reassuring people, trying to bring the firm back together to a place where we could be up and running and do business.
And so for a period of time, there was a rallying of sorts. There was a sense of, we're one firm. But the foundation just was never there.
As the economy began to rebound, Morgan Stanley saw some significant gains. But the company lagged behind its competitors in a number of businesses, and the cultural differences became more divisive.
There was a clash there, and I would say it can be portrayed as a culture clash if you like. But I would say we had a serious strategic difference. People within the company wanted us to lever up more and take more risk. At the time, I didn't agree with any of that.
People, largely retired people, but some active partners were saying, look, we got a real problem. There are issues about the direction of the firm. People were leaving, which was going to adversely affect the firm.
There was a lot of unrest about whether we had the right leadership to succeed. And this group of retirees start a fight.
The group of former Morgan Stanley executives seeking to oust CEO Philip Purcell say that if they prevail, they'd improve both profitability and employee morale.
We were obviously very unhappy at what was going on in the firm. His reputation was suffering. The share price was faltering. And when people started to leave, business started to get lost. We came to the conclusion very easily that something had to be done.
The Morgan Stanley dissidents believe Morgan is undervalued by some $30 billion, and cost savings can be achieved by fixing various businesses rather than selling them.
We just can't stand still and watch this franchise that's been created over a long period of time be run down.
The first reaction was, gee, this is never going to work. They don't own enough stock to make a difference. But they were loud, and frankly, they had spent their entire career influencing investors, and they were pretty darn good at it.
No, I didn't see that coming. I knew people had a different strategy they liked to pursue. I never would anticipate doing it the way they did it. I was inflexible, they were inflexible. I thought the best thing to do is for me to step aside. So I went home.
Some breaking news now from corporate America.
John Mack, he's back.
The board of directors unanimously elected John Mack as chairman and CEO of Morgan Stanley today.
This wasn't the Morgan Stanley that he left. This wasn't the Morgan Stanley that he grew up in. So as a leader, he had to acknowledge that he had two constituencies here.
I try to break down barriers. We just tried to fix some of the issues that were not being focused on. And one of the things we really needed was someone to run the retail business.
I'd spent a lot of my career advising companies. Morgan Stanley was going through its own difficulties. The retail brokerage business had been underperforming. And the sort of threshold question on the table was, should we sell it or try and turn it around?
And I said to him, this is your show. If you tell me this won't work, I'll listen to you, I'll shut it down. And if you tell me you can fix it, I'll give you all the support and we'll go forward. And he said, oh, this is fixable.
The question really is, once fixed, do you sell it or do you double it? And from day one, I was convinced the answer was you would double it. But first, we had to fix the business.